Perhaps the most glaring difference between the state-run sugar industries and the private millers is the use of state-of-the-art machinery, which enhances efficiency. Citizen TV has learned that some of the machines being used in the state-run sector are outdated. So bad is the situation that even the manufacturers do not make the machines anymore, which means in the event of a breakdown, it will take months to have the parts built from the scratch and then procured at exorbitant prices.
Why is it that in the state mills, a part that will cost less in the private sector mills costs more in the state sector mills? So there are procurement malpractices.
Last month, a report by the Sugar Directorate revealed high debt portfolios and high cost of production are some of the main issues bedeviling the sugar industry. Experts believe the counter to that will be to diversify the sugar company revenue streams, a move that will ensure the millers maximize on income and minimize wastage.
A sugar factory is multifunctional. It can produce a lot of things. It has multiple income revenues. If the price of sugar is low, they can turn on ethanol. If the price of ethanol is low, they can turn on electricity.
Another solution would be to merge the sugar industries under sound management. This could cut off unnecessary competition that has led to zoning, which is the seclusion of area codes by the sugar industries to guarantee a constant supply of cane. Paying the cane farmers on time would also lead to constant supply of sugarcane to the millers, a move that has been perfected by the private sugar industry.
We have a slogan that says farmer is king or queen, so everything we do it with a view of how we will treat any other king or queen. We pay them within 7 days of bringing in the sugarcane in the factory.
It does not make sense for a sugar company to mill cane from the farmer, sell the sugar and be unable to pay the farmer. What has happened?
On the 9th of August this year, a report on the inquiry of alleged importation of illegal and contaminated sugar into the country recommended the banning of raw sugar importation to avoid diversion of the sugar into the local market to safeguard the local sugarcane farmers. The report, however, was not adopted.
MPs wetu wamepotea. Hawaongei mambo ya miwa, hawaongei kitu yenye sisi tumeona kama wafanyikazi. Hawa wana safe interest fulani, tuna mtu anataka kununua ikambuni na hawa wanamsaidia.
Statistics show that state-owned millers are operating at an average of 46% of their optimal capacities due to worn-out equipment, lack of cane and poor cane varieties. Mumias, the largest miller with the capacity of nearly 8,000 tons a day, has only been operating at 12% its capacity. Pundits argue that if companies milled at between 80 to 90% of their capacity, the current demand of 800,000 metric tons would be reached and surpassed.
In efficient mills all over the world, about 8 tons of cane should produce 1 ton of sugar. But in state mills, you find almost 20 tons are utilized to produce 1 ton of sugar. So definitely, all these 10 tons is a waste.
Another proposal would be to adopt the farm gate pricing based on sucrose content. This would mean a change from the current sugarcane species to improved and better species in the farms. A move, pundits say, will open up the nucleus and zoning system adopted by sugar millers, which has been marred by allegations of favoritism and conflict of interest.
Even as the treasury prepares to pay farmers, then workers are not, workers' plight is not being addressed. We are asking, what is the problem? The board has abandoned us.
Currently, a 16-member sugar task force comprising of government officials and governors drawn from the sugar belt have embarked on a fact-finding mission in their various counties to come up with resolutions for the ailing sugar industry. The team is expected to convene early January to review the progress.